For those of you that feel like your circuits have been overloaded, that's always what my concern is. But I'm really always talking to hearts and not heads. So it doesn't bother me if you think your circuits are overloaded. Because I'm not praying for your intellectual comprehension. I'm not teaching for your intellectual comprehension. And the joy and the honor of being able to just speak about Jesus is enough to say, if what is said is true, he will use it. And he knows how to nurture it, and he knows how to bring it on along. I am very excited about what's going to happen here. I am. And I expect to come back here sometime to see this place full. I mean, I really do. The rain is much more than rain. It is truly the picture of God's blessing. And I have something I've been carrying on the inside. I want to tell you, this is, Lord, don't let me take too long here. I want to get back in the Word. But our own personal experiences in the Lord and the way that the Lord has disciplined us and spanked us and taught us and trained us and all that is all part of who we are in his work. And there's different places along the way that are really, really important. And so the big deal that we're dealing with and rediscover the heart is, can we rediscover the heart? Can we recognize that we're supposed to be aware that we're living on the basis of images instead of just living on the basis of images, not be aware of it? Okay. Because there's an absolute declaration that there's a veil over the heart until the veil's removed inside Christ. But we can be inside Christ and still think with the veil. We're still trying to get it with our intellect. There's one book in the world you can't get with your intellect, and it's God's Word. Jesus looked at a group of men that had the first 39 books memorized. There was not one or two in Israel. There's scores of young men in Israel, young 21-year-olds, that already had it memorized. This is a big deal. But he looked at these scribes and Pharisees. That's what they do. And he said these words, and I wish every Bible teacher in the world, born again, would constantly come to the Scripture. You search the Scriptures, because in them you think you have life, and they reveal me, and you won't come to me that you might have life. Now, nobody has to deal with that more than me, because I got all kinds of Scriptures memorized that I don't experience. And that means I'm not to him with that. I'm still dealing with it out here. Okay? He's the living Word. And the living Word is about a person. It's not about what's written on a sheet of paper. It's about the person. Everything in writing is a seed. And the purpose of the seed is to produce the person. Okay? So it's all about the person. We have the incredible declaration in Scripture that says the psuche of man cannot receive the things of the Spirit of God. The soul of man. You can't get it like you got history or engineering or whatever you studied. You can't get it. I don't mean you can't memorize it. You can memorize it just like you memorized them, but you can't get it. It only comes by revelation. Yes? It's a big deal. I just saw a note. Let me just see if I can go share it. There's so many things. There are so many things. But I was just looking in my little... I've written some jewels in here. Jewels, meaning seeds that he's given me. Let me just read one. It kind of reinforces where we've been. We're not saved by the death of Jesus. Rather, death is the condition or state from which all must be saved, including Jesus. Saved by life. And everything has to do with life has to do with the high priest who is alive, seated at the right hand of the Father, anointed king, Melchizedek, poured himself into him, and here we go. We've talked a lot about fractals, and we've not remotely talked enough about fractals. So I say it, and you probably don't know what I mean. But fractal is the first formula. It's the first time that a formula is put in place, and all the other times that it will be ever used will come out of that fractal being continually expanded, and it's loaded because look in the mirror, it used to be one cell. And everything that was in that one cell is who you become, is that one cell is continued to multiply and multiply and multiply. And the only thing that was not in that one cell is this piece of poison that came in from the outside, or the things we've been able to learn as we begin to be taught. But the equipment itself was inside the one cell. Yes?
Yes.
Okay. Now, the context behind that is that when Jesus became the firstborn from the dead, then we're made alive together with him. It's the same event. We're people of time and space, and we don't get that. So we resist that. But in the realm of the Spirit, the Father plugged us into what had happened then when we accept the truth about Jesus. But the truth about Jesus that brings life is that God raised him from the dead. I'm going to go one place. Lord, I'm already in trouble, but I really am. I mean, I'm not a little trouble. I'm in a lot of trouble. But it seems like I need to give you this verse, because what I want to encourage everybody in here is to quit trying to have faith. Have faith. Quit trying. Accept the revelation. Don't debate it. Say it's true, whether I understand it or not. I wish we had time for Thea to tell you how the Lord ran her down. Thea's an incredible gift to me and gift to you, and is an incredible example of what Jesus can do. Because she was a raving New Ager going as hard as she could go after trying to solve the issue about what's this all about and who is she and how she get this solved. That's what she was doing 7 years ago. Now she's teaching people who've been in ministry for 30 years. Because she knows what the heart is. She doesn't know all what the heart is, but she knows enough about what the heart is that she can teach people who don't know what the heart is. And that's, frankly, practically everybody we meet. I don't mean that in an arrogant way. I just mean we don't know what the heart is. So we try to battle, we try to grow, we try to do all this without knowing it's rest. I'm going to give you a verse and then we'll go. This is what Paul says to the Epicurean philosophers on Mars Hill, smartest people in the world except for those in Jerusalem. Okay. I want to tell you about this God you don't know about. That's what he does. But listen to this one statement. Therefore, having overlooked the times of ignorance, God is now declaring to men that all everywhere should repent. Change your thought processes. If it ends up with your crying and wailing, okay, but don't make that a requirement of that's what repentance is. Repentance is this, people, that becomes a work. People tell me, but where was the repentance? I'd say, well, go read Cornelius' household. Where's the repentance? It was real, and it's called that. Oh, God has given them the grace to repent. It's what it's called, repentance. There ain't no crying. They start praying in tongues and shouting. They're gone. The minute he said, whoever believes in this resurrected Jesus, sins are forgiven. That's a salvation message. Didn't say one thing about blood. Didn't say one thing about he died for our sins. That's explanation, not proclamation. Is everybody hearing me?
Yes.
The early church proclaimed. They didn't explain. God bore witness to the proclamation. And then once you become a believer, we can explain a lot of things that we're starting to understand. But the proclamation is very simple. They put him on the cross. God raised him from the dead. We witnessed him. We ate with him. And anybody that believes that he's alive. It's that simple. All of this is simple. It's just not simplistic. And the deeper you get in it, the simpler it gets. Everybody okay?
Yes.
All right. I'm going to Hebrews. I'm going to, what time did I stop? Tomorrow? okay, we're going to Hebrews. And we'll do this. Hopefully we'll do this well. Most of you already heard we went through watching the movie of the coronation of Jesus. That's what chapter 1 is. And I've already probably said this to you, but this is my life. I wake up in the middle of the night and I say, God, you spoke to the fathers in many portions, many ways, but now in these last days you've spoken to us inside the Son, who you made heir of all things, and through whom you made the world, and the radiance of the glory of God shining from his face. And on the inside, he's just like you because you named him God again. And just great salvation. Okay. Fractal. Meditation is assumed by the Father to be essential for your life and mine. Meditation is not reading. Meditation is meditating on what you read. Okay, it's ruminating. I loved it when my new daughter said, you need to be eating this word. Well, that's what I try to do. That's what meditation is. It's called regurgitation. You just do it over and over and over and over again. Okay? So, the book of Psalms starts, chapter 1, saying, you're supposed to meditate all day long. That's what it says. Chapter 1 is instructions to meditate. You can't meditate, according to Hebrew, if you're not seeing. You're not to meditation yet if all you're doing is hearing. Okay? So we say with our mouth, he said, take words and return me with them. I pray the word. In fact, if you were to hear my prayers, you'd say, boy, those are really boring prayers. He's not crying out. He's not begging. He's not asking. He's not. I'm just saying this is what's true, and I present it on behalf of this person. And this is what's true, and I present it on the behalf of this person. My prayers are 95% the word. I don't mean that I'm an example of what it's supposed to be. I just can't find myself spending a whole lot of time praying like men pray. Why would I use my words when I've got his and they go deeper and deeper and deeper? Does that make sense? See, Jesus prayed the word. Jesus, the best prayer ever was. Why did he quote the word? Because he had internalized the word. Not because he had authored it. So, chapter 1 is about meditation. Chapter 2 is a fractal psalm for the whole, every psalm that's in front and all the scripture that is in front forever. Chapter 2 of Psalms. Why do the nations rage and the people image vain things? It's for image. Why do people have wrong images? The kings of the earth and the rulers of the people take their stand together against the Lord and against his anointed. Against the Lord and his anointed. It's a prophetic scripture, yes? They say, let's get their restraints off. Let's get their bonds off of us. We don't want to deal with them. We don't want the restraint they want to put on. Please listen. See the movie, okay? The one who sits in heaven laughs. It's derisive laughter. It's sarcastic laughter. You're kidding me. I'm going to terrify you with what I say. Are you ready for what he said? Ve'ani nasakti malki azion arkadzi. I have poured myself into my king on Zion, the mountain of my holiness. Fractal, Melki, my king. Fractal, Melki, my king. I have libated, I've poured myself. Your translation is going to say something like establish. It's pour. And it's pour into. And you can't nasakti anything if you don't have a container that you're going to put it in. Okay, it's libation. It's the very word for the water libation, Steve, that's done at Sukkot. Okay, we bring this water in. 7 days, we're going to bring the water in, the water of libation. Yeah, and it's going to be poured out all day long, all 7 days long. Yeah, it is. But it's a picture of the real one. It's not the real one. It's a picture of the real one. Yes? I have poured myself into my king on Zion, the mountain of my holiness. And the next one that speaks is the sun. And the sun says, I will put in writing what Yahweh has spoken specifically to me, only it says the hoke. Hoke is a revelation that you can't get with the intellect. It's massive. This great hoke. So the sun says, I'm going to put in writing this great hoke, this great mystery that Yahweh has spoken specifically to me and nobody else. Are you ready for this?
Yes.
You are my son. Today I've become your father. Now ask of me, and I'll give you the nations as your inheritance and the ends of the earth as your possession. You'll rule over them with a rod of iron. That's not finished, folks. Oh, Lord. That was because I looked at the clock. Acts 4. Peter and John come to the believers and say, this is what happened with the rulers when we were in front of the rulers. And the people go to prayer. And they pray in unison. First half of Psalms 2. that's happened in this city. It happened. Pilate and Herod and the rulers of the people fulfilled the first half. Where's the people going to pray the second half? Where are they? Where's the people going to join him in what he's praying today? What he's praying today is what the Father told him. Now ask me and continue to ask me to give you the nations as your inheritance and in the earth as your possession. Now ask me. After I've said you're my son. But he hadn't said you're my son in that proclamation till he says it to him when he's in the abyss. Has nothing to do with the impregnation of Mary. His priesthood is in the power of an indestructible life. Indestructible life comes from being the firstborn from the dead. Then he's resurrected. Resurrection takes care of the Son of Man's problem. You're my son took care of the Son of God's problem. This one in the abyss has to be declared the Son of God before the Son of Man can be resurrected. Sequence is really important. Okay? Are you ready? We're going to Hebrews. Chapter 1. He's inherited much greater name than any of the angels, because which of the angels did he ever say, thou art my son, today I've begotten thee? I wonder where that comes from. Psalms 2. And again, from this point in time, in the future, he's saying this to the angelic host. Do you understand? We're watching a movie. He's just said to the son, you are my son, today I've begotten thee. And he says to everybody else that's observing it, I will be from now on and in the future a father to him, and he will be a son to me. Yeah. Does everybody see it? And then he says to the throne, to the son, he uses these terms that have to do with throne in it. Thy throne, O God's forever and ever. He didn't say king yet, but he says thy throne. He says, your scepter. He didn't say king yet, but he said scepter. He doesn't say king yet, but he says kingdom. So we got three words, fractal words here, that are all going to get plugged in before we're through to the king. We already know the king's name. We just don't know it in full. The king's name is my king, Melchi. I have poured myself into my king. Poured myself into him? That's not God the Son. That's the Son of Man. Son of God's God. Okay? The container is man. Okay? That's why I said there are no verses that talks about the Son of God coming back. He is the Son of God, but that's not the emphasis. The emphasis is the Son of Man's coming back. Man's coming. Jesus is a man, will forever be a man. The Word made flesh is forever flesh and will forever eternally be flesh. Not Wispy Gauzy, Casper the Friendly Ghost. Okay. Which of the angels did he ever say sit at my right? Wow. Anybody got a guess of which section of scripture in all of the Hebrew scripture is quoted the most and repeated in what we would call the Greek scriptures, or you might call the New Testament, and I can't get the words to come out, so I'll just say the post-resurrection scriptures, because they were all written post-resurrection. Okay? None of this was dictation while it's happening. Okay, we're looking backwards to see what's here, because it's written for us after he's glorified, and none of it's written before. Is that clear to everybody? A little bit? It'll change the way you read scripture if it's clear. Okay. We understand that everything has to do with life has to do with the high priest. Nothing has to do with life that doesn't have to do with the high priest. Nothing. Zero. Nothing. And we're ignorant of the high priest. I can't get anybody when I say Jesus to say he's my high priest. I guarantee you that this place over the next year will be absolutely knowing who the high priest is. I know that I know it because he's knowing it more than he ever knew it. And it's coming out. Okay? Okay. So which section of Scripture does the Father evidently think contains the most important information in all of Scripture? Psalm 110. Psalm 110 begins, "The Lord said to my Lord, sit at my right." Oh, what else does it say? Oh, it says, Nishba Elohim, Velo Yanahim. You're a high priest forever when I declare you Melchizedek. That's also Psalm 110. That's quoted six times, the Melchizedek. The other one's quoted seven. That's 13 out directly. Others refer to. That's 13 quotes in here, out of there, and there's no other verse or chapter in the Bible close. Do you think we ought to pay a little bit more attention to Psalm 110 than we've been paying? Well, I do. Okay, that's the way this closes the whole thing to get to this salvation, that he is the Son that has been made alive from the pit, and he's the one that the Father said, sit at my right. Remember last night, we talked about what's the day of Pentecost about? It's where the two shut your mouth questions are answered. Well, this is a movie. We see the movie, we never miss the importance of Jesus, shut your mouth questions. Shut your mouth. I got something to ask you. The Messiah, whose son is he? He's David's. That's absolutely proof that Jesus wasn't saying he was the Messiah. Whose son is he? Yeah. Well, if he's David's son, and David by the Spirit says he's his Lord, if he's David's Lord, how's he David's son? Shut your mouth. Nobody can answer that. Nobody. Day of Pentecost, time to answer it. Yeah. There it is. Now, we've got this great salvation. Don't drift. Pay much closer attention to what you heard. That's why I pray chapter 1 all the time. I'm paying much closer attention to what I heard. The gospel is about Jesus. It's not about you. Stop making it about you. It's not about you. It's for you. And you can never get how much it's for you as long as you're trying to figure out how it's for you. Because you're focused on you instead of on Jesus. Oh. Okay. Chapter 2 talks about the great salvation in Jesus. And then it gets over. And it says these wonderful words to us that there's something that has happened and there's something that's coming. The world to come, to concerning which we're speaking, is the one where Jesus returns. The whole message here is there's a great salvation that's going to be fully demonstrated on the earth, and it's coming. When he again brings his firstborn into the inhabited earth, he says, let all the angels worship it. And that's what we're talking about here, because that's what the next verse says down here. God bore witness, for he did not subject to angels the world to come concerning which we're speaking. But what is man? Well, man's the one you gave it to in the first place. What's the Son of Man? He's the one that you do it all through, not through the one. The Son of Man messed up, but the promise was made to man, so the Son of Man has to be the one that's all fulfilled to. Okay? He made him for a little while lower than the angels, but crowned him, please, here with glory and with honor. That sounds like what you'd do to a king. Glory and honor. Okay? Put him over all the works of your hands. Put all things in subjection under his feet. But we don't yet see it that way. Is everybody with me?
Yes.
But we do see Jesus. Really? Really? Crowned with glory and honor? That through death he's been crowned with glory and honor? That he might swallow up death for all time? Do we really see the glorified Jesus? I'm sorry, I can't find people seeing him. I'm sorry. I mean, I wish it weren't so. My wife says, Larry, you shouldn't say that so strong. You make people feel bad. I mean, you know that they know that he's alive. I know they know he's alive. But is it a concept or is it experiential? Are we seeing him or are we not seeing him? Well, this says we are seeing him. Crowned with glory and honor. Since the children share in flesh and blood, he himself partook of the same in order that through death he might render powerless him who had the power over death. That is the devil. And he might set free all of us, everybody in here, through fear of death, have been subject to slavery all of our lives. That's why we're self-centered. We're scared of death. And every person born is scared of death. All of our lives. Now watch this. This is really important. Surely he doesn't give help to angels, but to the seed of Abraham. I wonder why he said Abraham. I wonder why. Because Abraham's priest was Melchizedek. Give help to the sons of Abraham. Please hear this next thing. Therefore, he had to be made like us in some things. And that's not what he says. In all things. He had to be made like us in all things. He carried our sin, was made to be sin, and he became more like us than we've ever recognized what our likeness is. In order that he might become the merciful and faithful high priest. Boy, it's devastating to call John 17 the high priestly prayer of Jesus. We don't understand how the heart works. You can say that, don't recognize what you just said is his priest. No, he's not. He's not priest. He offers himself as the living lamb to be sacrificed. Agrees with the Father because he's the Father's lamb that the Father sacrificed. And he says, okay, I agree to be that. I don't want to, isn't there another way, but I agree. But he's not priest. He's the living lamb. He says, okay, do it to me. And he did that so he could become by birth, genomai, by birth. By birth he might become merciful and faithful high priest. Oh, by the way, to make propitiation of sin. The lamb doesn't propitiate sin. The high priest propitiates sin. The lamb becomes the propitiation offer. Death. Blood. The blood means to the Father somebody died. That's what blood means. The blood means the price has been paid. Can we get on with life? We keep acting like I need the blood every day. I need the blood every day. Well, these faithful, blood just keeps right on cleansing because it did what it's supposed to do. But the priest is there. Steve said something about approaching because there's nothing to resist. How did you say that? I've got it written down here. You talked about being free to approach because there's nothing to avoid. They said we won't draw near to God because we got to avoid him. I mean, we got all this guilt. We got all this junk. We got to avoid him. We can't pursue. And he said, pursue because there's nothing to avoid. Thank you. Thank you. You talk about rich. There's nothing to avoid. Okay. Now we're getting into, we don't have a high priest who can't sympathize with the weakness, but one who's been tempted in all things like us. Therefore, let us draw near. We don't even start to understand that the priesthood was to say, don't draw near. The whole point of the priesthood was to say, don't draw near. You can't do this. It's not safe for you. This says draw near. Approach. It's fixed. What the rip. Yeah. I play Romans 5 a whole lot. I'm in Hebrews 5. But I got to, what have I got, 10 minutes? Oh, good. I've got to go to 3. My life changed in Hebrew 3. Absolutely changed, 1979. Hebrews 3 exploded to me, and I've been there since 1979. Therefore, holy brethren, you're holy because of everything that's been said about Jesus, and none of it's been said about you. The subject of everything that's been said is Jesus. Am I going too fast? Are you with me? Okay. Therefore, holy brethren, partakers of a call from heaven, not a call to. You're partakers. You're born there. I love to ask this question. It's a wonderful question. Were you where your mother was when you were born? This is not hard. Were you where your mother was when you were born? I think the answer is yes. Well, were you where your mother was when you were born? Yes. Were you where your mother was when you were born above? Not again. Anuthan, above. Hagar is a symbol of present-day Jerusalem that has children to slavery. But Sarah is our mother, the new Jerusalem above. Sarah's our mother. You born where your mother was? If so, you're born above. Born above. Partakers of a heavenly calling. You've been born above. Now, this is huge. I need 3 days on what I'm about to say alone. I do. And I couldn't get much said because there's so much more. Therefore, holy brethren, katanoeo Jesus, the apostle and high priest of our confession. Katanoeo shows up 5 times. Noeo means think about it, evaluate it, analyze it, ponder it, calculate it some more. Just get it. Just get it. You follow me? All of the facts that you can get about Jesus as apostle and about Jesus as high priest, get it. And now do it. Start over. Katanoeo is being on measurement of going beyond noeo. It means really do it. Now that you've got it, now do it. Meditate on it now that you've got it. Okay? So that you can really get it. It's about this person. And 100% of it is based on what he did as apostle, what he did as high priest, more accurately, what God did to him as an apostle and what God is doing to him through him as a high priest. Because Jesus is still not doing anything independently of the Father. Nothing independent of the Father. Apostle means one sent. Jesus' apostle established all the facts that are ours to confess that have to do with his apostolic work. That's what he did. He was sent out to reveal the will of God concerning the activity of Satan. He was sent out to render powerless him who had the power over death through death. He was sent out to go about doing good and healing all who were oppressed by the devil. He was sent out to demonstrate that I am the authentic seed and I have to die so that what's happening through me can be available to my brothers and sisters. But none of it's available from me as the apostle, because nothing that has to do with life permanently is mine to give until I have died, been first born from the dead, restored to the glory I had, anointed, poured out, poured into. Whew. Now you got life. There is no life except from the high priest. Am I going too fast? Zero, no life except from the high priest. Apostle and high priest. He's the high priest of our confession, homologio, what we say, what we agree with God. But he also is the high priest of what I confess. He does with my agreement with him now what the priest of old did, present it to the Father. So how much have you said today that he could present to the Father? We sow to the Spirit. We present to the Son. And we offer sacrifice and praise to the Father. Sow to the Spirit, present to the Son, and offer his sacrifice of praise and worship to the Father. They're all three always involved. There's never one of them sitting on the sideline. Okay? All right, we're going. Oh, my. Five is so awesome. Every high priest taken from among men is appointed on behalf of men and things pertaining to God. How many things pertaining to God are the responsibility of the high priest? 100%. Every high priest taken from among men is appointed on behalf of men and things pertaining to God. In order to offer both gifts and sacrifices for sins, he can deal gently with the ignorant and misguided. Isn't that good? You ever felt ignorant and misguided? Every single time I get here, I've got something fresh. You follow me? I got something fresh every time I get here. Yesterday, or this morning, or the middle of the night, I still got something fresh that I've been ignorant or misguided on. Since he himself was beset with weaknesses. Excuse me. Well, no, he had to be made like us in all things. He can deal gently. Because he's obligated to offer, hear this, for sins, for the people, so also for himself. Jesus couldn't get back without blood. He has to offer for himself first, and then for the sins of the people. We could get in the Day of Atonement, and you see it clearly. The bulls for the high priest and for his sons. The goats for the people. Okay? Now, here it comes. Get ready. Are you ready?
Yes.
No one takes the honor to himself. No one. But receives it when he's called by God, just as Aaron. Therefore, Christ did not glorify himself so as to become high priest. What's the glory of Jesus? High priest. When you talk about glorifying Jesus, we can say the words all day long and not have an image of what we're talking about. Don't mean the Spirit's not in this. Doesn't mean we can't. I love to watch the dancing. I love it. I was a dancer. I was a rock and roll dancer, but I was a dancer. When I got run down by the Lord, I said, I didn't know I could still dance. Love it. I love it. But everything will change. This place will explode the minute the vast majority of the people in here are looking at a king seated on the throne with seven rays of light coming from his face and seven eyes that's in it. And that's what the image is. The Father says, watch what I do coming into that. He didn't glorify himself so as to become high priest, but the one who said to him, this is amazing. He's got to first go back and quote, you are my son, today I've begotten. And then he's going to say, then after he says, the one who said, this is how you get to be the priest, because you're the son birthed from the abyss. Also says in another passage, thou art a priest forever. When I declare you Melchizedek, I know yours says after the order, that's not what the Hebrew says. Well, this is where Steve and I first got here, because I'd said to him, Jesus on the cross is not the Savior. The high priest is the Savior. And he says, where does it say that? And so I said, well, let's go over here and say this. Although it was the Son, and Steve can quote it perfectly, I know, because I quoted it perfectly, and he quoted it perfectly with me. But he just said, where does it say it? So he could quote it, but he didn't know what it meant. Well, I got tons of verses I can quote that I don't know what they mean. It's not Steve, it's me. It's not us, it's you. Okay? Having been made perfect, he became to all those who obey him the source of eternal salvation, being designated by God Melchizedek. Who's the Savior? Now, this next statement is absolutely staggering. Are you ready?
Yes.
Concerning him, Melchizedek. It's not abstract, folks. Concerning him, there's so much to say. Palouse, it's huge. I've got so much to say about Melchizedek, but it's hard to explain because you're dull of hearing. By this time, you ought to be teachers. What's he talking about? Teaching about what? There's only one subject here, that Jesus is Melchizedek. You ought to be teachers, but you need somebody to teach you the elementary things of Christ. You've come to need milk and not solid food. For one who partakes of milk is a baby because he does not have an experience of the word of righteousness. Babies don't know they're righteous. How can you have a dirty diaper and know you're righteous? When I came to the Lord, I didn't know who I could go to say, I'm consumed by pornography and lust. I'm consumed by it. Who can I go talk to about this? Who can I say? That didn't all disappear just because I discovered myself believing in Jesus. Who's going to teach me that he's the only answer to that? And that I'm not supposed to be fighting Satan. Get in the throne room and see if Satan can go with you. You know how he taught me how to get free from pornography? A long time before he taught me about the heart. He said, change the picture. He said, change the picture. 13 to 14 years before, he said, you need to learn a little bit more about what this picture and this heart thing is. He said, change the picture. And you can't have a tempting thought without images. Science absolutely says what God's already said. It's impossible to have a thought without an image. Change a picture. You change the picture, guess what? The tempting image is gone. I can change the picture. I change the picture to taking a scripture and go running in the throne room. Here it is. Okay. Chapter 6. Therefore, leaving the elementary things about Christ, let us press on to maturity. What an amazing statement. Guess what it means? Let's leave the elementary things of Christ. Guess what it means in the Greek? Leave. Don't keep dealing with a dead man. He ain't dead. Don't keep trying to do it yourself. You got a priest that's responsible for all of it. Somebody heard me. Every high priest taken from among men is appointed on behalf of men and things pertaining to God. All the things pertaining to God are the responsibility of the high priest. My responsibility is to acknowledge it. Okay, now, so he stops because this warning, he stops and says, there's all kinds of things going on here, but we've got to turn and we've got to understand that he's going to come right back to where he was before he took his break of warning. He's going to get in 6 and he's going to say, beloved, we're convinced of better things concerning you, things that accompany salvation. Yeah, you had a born-again experience. Would you like what accompanies that? Would you like to experience what happened with that birth? Would you like to experience it? Okay. Here's what accompanies it. You have to have a full assurance of hope. I don't have time to do this, but I can absolutely take this and show you that the hope is focused on what the high priest will do, not on the basis of anything he has done. Faith is based on what he has done. Hope is focused on what he will do. We pray in faith with hope. Stop trying to have faith for anything. Nobody in Scripture had faith for anything. They had faith in and hope for. And that'll bring you massive rest. Massive rest. Well, where is this hope located? Well, it's based on an oath. When God made the promise to Abraham, he couldn't swear by anybody greater, so he swore by himself. I'm going to really bless you. I'm going to really multiply you. And Abraham, having faithfully waited, he obtained the promise. Men swear by one greater than themselves. And with them, an oath given as confirmation is the end of every single debate. It's over. The conflict's over. That word's a conflict word. Conflict's over. Okay? God desiring in the same way as men, even more, to show to the heirs of the promise the unchangeableness of his purpose, he interceded with an oath in order that by two unchangeable things, in which it's impossible for God to lie. That's his oath. We might have strong encouragement. Those of us who flee for refuge and laying hold of the hope set before us. Not the faith set before us. The hope set before us. This hope is an anchor of the soul. It's steadfast and it's sure. Why? Because steadfast is the purpose of God and sure because of the oath of God. Sure, it's that kind of anchor. It's based off what he says. His purpose and his oath. We might enter in through the veil where Jesus entered as a high priest, forerunner. Has it got anything else in there? Oh, Melchizedek. Now, this Melchizedek, what's the antecedent of this? It's not abstract. It's this. We've just been talking about this. This Melchizedek, king of Salem, priest of the Most High God, met Abraham. It's huge. This is him. Without father, without mother, without genealogy. Everything to the Jews are based on genealogy. What do you mean without genealogy? Having neither beginning of days nor end of life, but made like the Son of God, he abides a priest perpetually, forever. You know how many places you can look and they'll say Melchizedek was this king back here, and to make a point, his father wasn't recorded and his mother wasn't recorded and his genealogy wasn't recorded. And I say, well, what else do you not believe that the Bible says? Exactly. I mean, I've had some mature men of God tell me that. And I say, what else don't you believe? You frighten me. If God says he doesn't have a father, don't you tell me he has one, please. He says he don't have a mother, don't you? Say, no, he have a mother. It just is not recorded for some reason. He doesn't have a genealogy. He didn't have beginning of days, and you're telling me he did have beginning of days? What is this? This is insanity. There's no integrity. Father, may I never ignore your word. May I never minimize your word. May I never reinterpret your word. May I never declare it fulfilled in any way other than you meant it when you said it. I don't care what you don't understand it. Just say, Melchizedek didn't have a father, he didn't have a mother, he didn't have a genealogy, he didn't have a beginning of days, he didn't have an end of life. He made like the Son of God and he's a priest forever. Say it because that's what it says. Someday, if you keep saying it, you might discover yourself believing it. Okay? How great a man this was. You see, man? How great a man this was. He's manifested as a man. And he blessed the one who had the promise. We have to be among the people who get to the awareness that what we're asking for is the high priest to bless the promise that's been given to us by God. We're not holding on to this promise out of our human strength. We're holding on to the promise because we believe that God said it, and then we ask Jesus to bless it. Originated with him, but I need your priestly blessing on this promise. Yes. This is the good news right here. It's about this priesthood. He abides a priest forever. The oath, by the way, is not to us. The oath is over in chapter 7. After he says Melchizedek again, the priesthood changed. If the priesthood changed, there has to be a change of the covenant. There has to be a change of law, which happens first. Priesthood changes. So the Lord is sworn and will not change his mind. Does everybody recognize that's a quote from where? Psalm 110. There it is. We have. When is this taking place and who's the one it takes place to? You'll be a priest forever. He abides a priest forever. His priesthood is permanent because it's in the power of an indestructible life. He is born from the abyss with the power of an indestructible life. He didn't have an indestructible life before he went into the pit and died. It's not possible for somebody that has indestructible life to die. This is not complicated, folks. It's really not. I know it sounds strange because we don't talk about it, but it's not complicated. It's really simple. Therefore, he's able to save forever. Well, who is this? Melchizedek's able to save forever. Those who draw near to God through him, since he ever lives, to make intercession for him. Now, we started this morning. Priest has got the crown, and the crown says, holy to the Lord, so that the people offering sacrifices will be set apart by the holiness of the priest. Therefore, Ratzon, acceptable time. Now is acceptable time. Now, right now. When is acceptable time? Now, if we're aware that the priest he's got the crown on his head. It's not abstract. Oh, now is the acceptable time. Why is it the acceptable time now? Because it's a priest with holy to the Lord crown. Melchizedek, king. We sing about king. We talk about a king and say, tell me the king you're talking about. Well, Jesus is a king. Really? Tell me more. Well, he's the king. Well, that's not telling me more. Well, he says he's King of Kings and Lord of Lords. That's when he returns. And it's true. But he's king right now to everybody that has the revelation. And the king that he is right now to everybody that has the revelation is the priest that's responsible for everything pertaining to God. Okay? Now, you all are worn out, I can tell by the looks. Where we got to go sometimes, and maybe we'll do some special night through the system. I wanted desperately to get 2 Corinthians 3. Desperately. But you can't go there if you don't understand who Melchizedek is. Because 2 Corinthians chapter 3 is about the contrast between the glory that was in Moses' face that was so bright that nobody could look, and the glory that's in the face of Jesus. It is the fullest expression that exists in Scripture of what Thea gave yesterday. It's packed with glory. The glory, the glory, the glory of the Spirit, the glory of the ministry of righteousness. Just said Melchizedek, didn't I? Okay? The glory that surpasses and the glory that's eternal. Therefore, having such a hope. We use great boldness in our speech. We're not like Moses who put a veil over his face. Moses put a veil over his face and the people, their thoughts were darkened. And for this very day, whenever the old covenant is read, a veil's over the hearts. Because it's removed in Christ. And whoever turns to the Lord, the veil's taken away. It's not hard. Just turn. The veil is flesh. The veil is the view of I'm a self-contained power source. The veil is about me. It's not about you. It's about him. As long as you think it's about you, there's a veil. Okay, how can I get this fixed? Well, can I really learn this? Can I really get this? It's not about you. Turn. When we turn, the veil is removed. We all, really, with unveiled face, beholding in a mirror the glory of the Lord. Kapto trizomai. It's a mirror that only spiritual people could see. Remember, mirror, mirror on the wall, who's the fairest of the wall? Okay? That's the kind of mirror. It's a mirror. The Holy Spirit uses that word because in that world they tried to look in mirrors to get revelation. That's the very word that he uses to say, okay, let me communicate what this really is. It's kapto trizomai. It's beholding as in a mirror the glory of the Lord. Are being transformed, metamorphosis, from one degree of glory from the next, just as from the Lord the Spirit. I'm going to say something that should bless you, but may frustrate you first. There's no transformation promised unless we're looking at the glory of God in the face of Jesus. So we're not very transformed. We look a whole lot like everybody else, and we act a whole lot like everybody else. We don't have much experience to look at the glory of God in the face of the resurrected Jesus. Paul gave us an incredible blessing. He said, we see through a glass darkly. There'll be no scripture that you appreciate more when you start going after the heart, an image of the heart, than Paul saying, we see through a glass darkly. Okay? Thea knows it well, hears me say it, and she can say it herself. I can talk it so much better than I can walk it. It's not funny. Talk it. But what about if somebody stands up out here and says, I think everything you said is false. I think you're from Satan. I think, how will I handle that? Will I respond or will I react? If I react, I do what was being done. If I respond, it's the Holy Spirit. Okay? Well, don't anybody try because I don't want to be tested. But this is a huge place. Can I go to one?
Yes.
I'm pushing the bubble, but there's a whole presentation that some of you saw a little bit of that is really critical. It's stunning to me. There has been a huge scientific breakthrough that took place that was revealed to the world on August the 19th. Researchers dealing with brain and what's going on up here. In 2008, trained a rhesus monkey to walk on a treadmill and walk on that treadmill until he was so programmed as a she, probably had to be a she. Sorry, guys. Yeah. He did reveal himself to Mary first. Okay. So the monkey's trained so that it now responds to what's happening here on the treadmill and falls lockstep. Walks at the pace, speeds up, almost runs. And they identify this as 250 nerve cells. That has stored this inside the rhesus monkey. So the rhesus monkey is walking now and does it all the time on command, in step, with 250 nerve cells. We've got a quadrillion synapses. We got 1,000 billion nerve cells. So 250 is not too many, right? Once they have the rhesus monkey doing this, They intersect the cells coming off of the electrical impulses coming off of those 250 cells, send them to a humanoid robot in Kyoto, Japan, and the robot in Kyoto, Japan starts walking on the basis of the signals coming from the rhesus monkey's 250 nerve cells. Hello? And you wonder if we can get what the Father's sending? But that doesn't even get it started. The next thing that happens is the monkey is totally unaware of the Kyoto, Japan robot. But then they take a screen and they put the robot in front of the monkey. And the monkey can now see the robot walking on the basis of the monkey's signals. And the next day, the monkey's internalized that that's me. That I'm united with that. And reprograms that. Oh, it's up there. Okay. Sorry. It's being done. That's what's happening. When the monkey starts seeing the images there, it starts putting those images inside its brain, stores new images inside the brain. Can we go to the next, please? And then they give signals for the monkey to stop walking. So the 250 signals that are making the monkey walk stop, because that's what they're programmed to do. But it now has X number of new signals of the robot walking, and it keeps the robot walking. Yeah. With the new programming that's in here. That's a robot. It can't walk. Do you understand? That's nothing but computer-generated signals coming from. But this monkey has done this. Does everybody see that?
Yeah.
Okay, now that becomes huge. Here's where this is going. These people that were doing this turned to paraplegics. And when they went to work with paraplegics, let's don't keep doing the slides because that'll just throw me off. I can't watch it. Just let me talk this through and we'll look at it another time. No, I mean, I really need to hurry. They turned to paraplegics, saying, okay, what can we learn from here to help these paraplegics? Maybe there's something here can be done. When they do the research on the paraplegics, they make a huge discovery. The paraplegics have no brain cells for walking. They're gone. These were not by birth. These were all by accident. They're gone. They have no images of walking. Okay? But the monkey had taught them something. Maybe we can put new images of walking in. So they get virtual reality headsets and they put avatar in there from the waist down and ask them to imagine walking. And they reprogram some places in here on the images of an avatar walking. And the big demonstration to the world was 2014 Brazil World Cup, and they had a paraplegic make the opening kick. With the image maker. They made the opening kick. But that's just the tip of the iceberg. They didn't know what was happening. But within 6 months' time, everybody that they were doing this testing with began to get feeling in their actual body without the exoskeleton that they were walking in. They got bowel control back, a lot of them. One woman gave birth to a baby. Now, those paraplegics have given birth before, but they were cesarean. This is a woman said, no, I think I've got enough strength to push. Paraplegic gave birth to a baby. Now, what's the end result of that? What's the end result of that really say? It says that God's way ahead of science. And it says that if you get the images right on the inside, it can have effect all over the body. Now, what I just described to you is that there was paraplegics were locked in place because they had no images of walking. I'm going to submit something to you. And you have to promise to love me anyway, whether you like it or not. I think science just revealed the reason for spiritual paraplegia. Because the body of Christ as a whole has no functional images of the glorified Jesus. And we're going to the cross trying to get something by claiming it and declaring it. I prophesy and I just all that gymnastics that's religion. It's sincere, but it's religion. Okay? It's soulish to the core. I will do the things of the Spirit. You'll do a cheap imitation, but you will not do the things of the Spirit if the Spirit doesn't initiate. Okay? We're supposed to be focused on the living, resurrected Jesus. We're supposed to remember his death with communion and focus on his life. And I've got a whole set of scriptures that have to do with a couple we've looked at. We see Jesus. We all with unveiled face beholding the face of the glorified Jesus. Those scriptures are what I feed on all the time because I want the imagery that comes from the Spirit when I'm presenting those words. And I can begin to see through a glass darkly and see those images. So I think science just said, the church is spiritual paraplegic. Can talk it. Can raise our hands. How good do we do at walking it? I think we're spiritual paraplegics. I didn't say I think you are. I said, I think we are. Because Jesus really did say, the things that I've done, you will do. Greater things will you do than I did. Amen. Don't stop. Don't stop. I can tell you churches that stopped. Don't stop. Because I go to the Father. It's not you'll do them. It's I'll do them. Through you, from the Father, as Melchizedek, the high priest. I'll do it. You fellowship with me. You just keep fellowship with me. And watch how I'll open doors and I'll use you. Stop trying to be used. Stop trying to be used. Just be available. Fellowship with the high priest. Can we pray? Lord, I don't know all you wanted to get done, and I don't know all you got done. But thank you for the opportunity to begin to look. That you pull back the veil and let us see just a little bit more of what you want us to see about all you've said and done inside your Son. And that we become those who can, like Paul say, it's our joy to bring to light the administration of the mystery, which for ages was hidden in God, created all things in order that the manifold wisdom of God might now be revealed through the believers to the rulers and authorities in the heavenly places in accordance with his eternal purpose, which he carried out in Yeshua HaMashiach, our Lord. Let it be. Let it be in this place. Cause the waters outside to be nothing but a symbol and a shadow of what's going to take place in here. I ask you to bless Steve and Cammy and all the maturity that's in this place. There's so much work that has been done, preparation. But now we need to go on. We need to take all that you've done and all that you've said and say, let's go further back and higher up. Let's get into the place where this light that is in Jesus' face, that so a glimpse Moses that we understand there's a huge difference between the ministry of the letter which kills and the ministry of the Spirit which gives life. And Lord, we acknowledge you've sent your Spirit to glorify you, to take of the things that are yours and to reveal them, that you speak to the Spirit. The Spirit says nothing except what he hears you say. So our dependency is on a man seated. You gave us an image, Father, for our image maker, so we wouldn't be looking at things that can't be seen, but you gave us the image of a man so we could have something we could see and relate to and know. And it's the preeminent image that you designed for us to be focused on. And when he comes and we see him as he is, we will instantly become just like him. But now we see him like the light that shines in the dark place, as a day star rises in our hearts. The day star, the measure by which we see the glorified Christ now, rise in our hearts. Didn't say rise in the earth, Father. Rise in our hearts. So cause it to happen. Cause it to happen in us. In Jesus' name and for his glory. Amen.
Thank you, Larry. Thank you, everyone, for just holding your place and listening well. We'll have a couple of buckets that those of you who are just haven't had a chance to sow and to send Larry and Thea back out in a manner that you would want to, in a manner God would want to. There'll be offering buckets on either side that you can write a check to Jubilee Church or place an envelope in. Just everybody stand. I want to just thank God and release the blessing over us as we go. Thank you. Aren't you glad this is all online? So you can kind of go and just behold and pause and start over and go back in and start. Now we can start meditating. It's been introduced. It's been sent in. It's been sown. Now we can water it and grow it. So, dear Father, we thank you for this sovereign time inside of rain as you rain down righteousness and light and love. And you have brought forth sound and sight. And we receive the words, like Paul said of the Thessalonians, that they didn't receive them as the words of men, but the words from God, about God, that we might behold who you are so that we might become who you are. In you, Lord, seal in us, in Christ, by Holy Spirit, who continues to guard that which we have been given as a guarantee of what is coming in fruition and fulfillment. We do not disengage because our mind cannot keep up or it is challenged. We simply come now intentionally to sit at the feet of Jesus and listen to his words and to behold so we might become. We thank you for the faithfulness of our journey and all that we've learned till now, and we look forward as we launch now into the deep. And maybe we fished all night before and didn't get any, but at your word, we'll let down the net. We'll let down the net and we'll pull up the things that you have for us now and we'll behold you in the way you want us. We thank you. Let it grow online throughout our body and throughout the world in the body of Jesus Christ. Amen. 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 God bless you. Thank you so much. Oh yeah, and Thailand meeting is at 1 o'clock. So those of you who want to go love Thailand, it'll be in room 9. Petey will be there. Thanks for picking up your kids early, we'll see you. Wednesday, we have a chance for some questions and answers. Send your questions on email or bring them with you, and you can do them online or live.